Penguin Random House Audio presents The Girl in the Spider's Web by David Lagercrantz, translated from the Swedish by George Goulding, read for you by Simon Vance. Prologue. 1 year earlier. This story begins with a dream, and not a particularly spectacular one at that. Just a hand beating rhythmically and relentlessly on a mattress in a room on Lundergarten. Yet it still gets Lisbeth Salander out of her bed in the early light of dawn. Then she sits at her computer and starts the hunt. Part 1. The Watchful Eye. November 1st to 21st. The NSA, or National Security Agency, is a US federal authority that reports to the Department of Defense. The head office is in Fort Meade, Maryland, by the Patuxent Freeway. Since its founding in 1952, the NSA has been engaged in signals surveillance, these days mostly in connection with internet and telephone traffic. Time after time, its powers have been increased, and now it monitors more than 20 billion conversations and messages every 24 hours. Chapter 1. Early November. Franz Balder had always thought of himself as a lousy father. He had hardly attempted to shoulder the role of father before, and he did not feel comfortable with the task now that his son was 8. But it was his duty. That is how he saw it. The boy was having a rough time living with Balder's ex-wife and her obnoxious partner, Lasse Westman. So Balder had given up his job in Silicon Valley, gotten on a plane home to Sweden, and was now standing at Arlanda Airport, almost in shock, waiting for a taxi. The weather was hellish. Rain whipped onto his face, and for the 100th time, he wondered if he was doing the right thing. That he, of all self-centered idiots, should become a full-time father. How crazy an idea was that? He might as well have gotten a job at the zoo. He knew nothing about children and not much about life in general. The strangest thing of all was nobody had asked him to do it. No mother or grandmother had called him, pleading and telling him to face up to his responsibilities. It was his own decision. He was proposing to defy a long-standing custody ruling and, without warning, walk into his ex-wife's place and bring home his boy, August. No doubt all hell would break loose. That damn Lasse Westman would probably give him a real beating. But he put that out of his mind, and got into a taxi with a woman driver who was dementedly chewing gum and at the same time trying to strike up a conversation with him. She would not have succeeded even on one of his better days. Balder was not one for small talk. He sat there in the back seat, thinking about his son and everything that had happened recently. August was not the only, or even the main reason why he had stopped working at Solifon. His life was in turmoil, and for a moment he wondered if he really knew what he was getting himself into. As the taxi came into the Vasastan neighborhood, Balder felt as if all the blood was draining from his body. But there was no turning back now. He paid the taxi on Torsgarten and took out his luggage, leaving it just inside the building's front entrance. The only thing he took with him up the stairs was an empty suitcase covered with a brightly colored map of the world, which he had bought at San Francisco International. He stood outside the apartment door, panting. With his eyes closed, he imagined all the possible scenarios of fighting and screaming, and actually, he thought, you could hardly blame them. Nobody just turns up and snatches a child from his home, least of all a father whose only previous involvement had consisted of depositing money into a bank account. But this was an emergency, so he steeled himself and rang the doorbell, resisting the urge to run away. At first, there was no answer. Then the door flew open, and there was Westman, with his piercing blue eyes and massive chest and enormous fists. He seemed built to hurt people, which was why he so often got to play the bad guy on screen, even if none of the roles he played, Balder was convinced of this, were as evil as the person he was in real life.
"Christ," Westman said, "look what we have here. The genius himself has come to visit. I'm here to fetch August, Balder said.
You what?
I'm taking him away with me, lassie.
You must be joking.
I've never been more serious, he tried.
And then Hanna appeared from a room across to the left. True, she was not as beautiful as she had once been. There had been too much unhappiness for that, and probably too many cigarettes and too much drink as well. But still he felt an unexpected wave of affection, especially when he noticed a bruise on her throat. She seemed to want to say something welcoming, even under the circumstances, but she never had time to open her mouth.
Why should you care all of a sudden? Vestman said. Because August has been through enough. He needs a stable home.
And you think you can provide that, you freak? Since when have you done anything except stare at a computer screen?
I've changed, he said,
feeling pathetic, in part because he doubted that he had changed one little bit. A shiver ran through Balder as Westman came towards him with his mighty bulk and his pent-up rage. It became crushingly clear that he would have no means of resistance if that madman let fly. The whole idea had been insane from the start, but surprisingly, there was no outburst, no scene, just a grim smile, and then the words,
Well, isn't that just great?
What do you mean? Hanna asked.
That it's about time, isn't it, Hanna? Finally, some sense of responsibility from Mr. High and Mighty. Bravo! Bravo!
Vestman clapped his hands theatrically. Afterwards, that was what Balder found most frightening. How easily they let the boy go. Perhaps they saw August only as a burden. It was hard to tell. Hanna shot Balder some glances which were difficult to read, and her hands shook and her jaw was clenched. But she asked too few questions. She should really have been cross-examining him, making thousands of demands, warning him and worrying that the boy's routine would be upset. But all she said was,
Are you sure about this? Will you manage?
I'm sure, he said.
Then they went to August's room. Balder had not seen him for more than a year, and he felt ashamed. How could he have abandoned such a boy? He was so beautiful and strangely wonderful with his curly, bushy hair and slender body and serious blue eyes, engrossed in a gigantic jigsaw puzzle of a sailboat. His body seemed to cry out, Don't disturb me. And Balder walked up to him slowly, as if approaching an exotic creature. He nonetheless managed to get the boy to take hold of his hand and follow him out into the corridor. He would never forget it. What was August thinking? What did he imagine was happening? He neither looked up at him nor at his mother, and of course he ignored all the waving and the words of farewell. He just vanished into the lift with Balder. It was as simple as that. August was autistic. He was most likely also mentally disabled, even though they had not received unequivocal advice on that point, and anyone who saw him from afar might suspect the opposite. His exquisite face radiated an air of majestic detachment, or at least suggested that he did not think it worth bothering with his surroundings. But when you looked at him closely, there was something impenetrable in his gaze. He had yet to say his first word. In this, he had failed to live up to all the prognoses made when he was 2 years old. At the time, the doctors had said that August probably belonged to that minority of autistic children who had no learning impairment, and that, provided he was given intensive behavioral therapy, his prospects were quite good. But nothing had turned out as they had hoped, and Balder had no idea what had become of all that remedial care and assistance, or even the boy's schooling. Balder had run away to the United States and lived in his own world. He had been a fool, but now he was going to repay his debt and take care of his son. Right away, he ordered casebooks and called specialists and educational experts, and it became immediately apparent that none of the money he had been sending had gone towards August's care, but instead had trickled out to pay for other things, probably Vestman's extravagances and gambling debts. The boy seemed to have been left pretty much to his own devices, allowed to become set in his compulsive ways, and probably worse. This was also the reason why France had come home. a psychologist had called to express concern about unexplained bruises covering August's arms and legs, chest and shoulders. According to Hannah, they were because the boy had fits and hurt himself thrashing back and forth. Balder had witnessed one already.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.